We're back, this time from my new office on Vancouver Island, and to celebrate, Facebook says it wants you to upload all your dirty pictures to them. No, really. That and Instagram finally reveals how their algorithm works. There is lots to cover from a new office, it's kind of echoey here, today on This Week in Digital Marketing. I'm very excited. My wife and I moved to Vancouver Island. Those of you who have been following the saga will know that last week we took the show off because we were right in the middle of moving. That was our actual moving day. So I'm here in the new office, which is echoey and empty. I did put some of my posters up, though, some of my JFK collection. So I'm pretty excited about that. Behind me is going to be the set for this that I'm actually going to get starting building later on. The set is going to be a full studio, so this will look pretty sharp, I hope. I'm excited about that. Also, sorry that I didn't shave, in case my mom is watching. All right, lots to cover today on the show. Oh, you know what? I didn't start my recording for the podcast, people, so I'm going to do that, and then we'll get started. But first, before we do that, you will find pinned to the bottom of this link this little to this video. You'll see this little thing here. If you wouldn't mind clicking on that bit.ly link, what it'll do is it'll pop up. If you're logged into Twitter, it'll pop this up and you can retweet it. You can also edit it if you want to as well. This, by the way, is what our living room currently looks like from our security camera. As you can see, we are still moving in quite a bit. All right, let's do this for the podcast people. We're back, this time from my new office on Vancouver Island, and to celebrate, Facebook says it wants you to upload all your dirty pictures to them. No, really. That and Instagram finally reveals how their algorithm works. Lots to cover today on the return of This Week in Digital Marketing. And if you are listening to this as a podcast, you are missing out on a whole ton of stuff, notably the visuals. We do this live every Friday on Facebook, and you can watch yourself. You can find out how to do that. Just go to thisweek.news. That's thisweek.news. That's where you'll be able to watch this episode so you don't miss out on the screenshots and charts and everything. But regardless of how you're listening or watching, that website will let you sign up to get a reminder an hour before we go live with the full upcoming agenda. Once again, that's at thisweek.news. Welcome, Albert. Welcome, Jocelyn, everyone else who's watching. And if you wouldn't mind letting me know how the microphone is for those of you on the live video, I do have my good microphone finally pulled out of a box, so I'm keen to know whether it's over-modulating. If it sounds too tinny, I'll turn it down. All right, here is what is on today's show. We're going to start with Instagram. So Instagram, for the first time, has actually explained how their algorithm works, which is nice, because up until now, we've really been just kind of guessing. So we've got some news on that. There's another study that says, does frequency hurt you or help you? In other words, posting more. There is some data that seems contradictory, but actually is in favor of doing more. You turn down the volume by 60%. Okay. That's good to know. Everyone is rolling in. Hi, Angela. Hi, Jonathan. Hi, Jen. Hi, Jonathan. Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming in. So are you not using stories ads on Instagram? You're not alone. Lots of other brands are skipping it as well. At mention sharing is here for brands and for profiles. I'll tell you how that works. They have an easy cross share now available over on Facebook. You know, this is not a huge surprise. Facebook has been sending less traffic to websites. We now actually have the data to show that Google has overtaken that once again. Facebook TV, very interesting. Some big names coming to Facebook with shows, like daily shows at specific times. Shows that Facebook is paying those. And we're talking like Anderson Cooper and Shepard Smith, some big names on that going to that. You will be able to boost now in Marketplace. That is the Facebook, the Craigslist killer. Speaking of killing products, remember how they tried to buy Snapchat and Snapchat told them to stuff it, so they went and basically killed off Snapchat? I mean, Snapchat's still around, but they copied everything and put it over on Instagram. Guess what? Facebook has a new target. I will tell you who what that is. Here's a little hint. We have already talked about them on the show about 2 months ago. Very interesting application, an actual program that you run on your computer for instant articles. As I mentioned off the top, Facebook wants you to upload all your nude photos to them. This is not a joke. They actually do. There is a pretty good reason for it, though. Turns out Facebook is getting pricey for some brands. The Facebook ads, we've got some data around that. You can no longer share boost shared posts. A couple of other little things, some nice additions to groups management that I found. And over on Pinterest, they have some full screen video ads that are launched. As always, this is sponsored by my social engagement agency, EngageQ. We work with some of the biggest brands in the country, like the CBC, the Mountain Equipment Co-op Company, the Grey Cup, the Vancouver Sun Run, Pacific Coastal Airlines, Sheridan Wall Center, Hotel, a whole bunch of people. And we'd love to work with you as well. If you have any digital marketing or social media needs, we are at EngageQ.com. That's EngageQ.com. And by the way, just before we get started, there does seem to be a bug on Facebook Lives. So if your brand runs Facebook Lives, be aware that this bug seems to exist. I haven't seen anyone else report this. I just noticed it this morning. When I went to, at about 10:55, I went to update the agenda, and it said that I was going live at 11. I'm like, holy shit, 11? So I ran upstairs, I put on a shirt, this is like 5 minutes to go. I got my stuff ready to go, and then I checked it again, and it said 10, or it said 12. So just be aware of that. If you have a brand page and you're doing Facebook Lives, there seems to be a glitch in the ointment. Obviously, since you're all here, it worked at the regular time that I did actually schedule it for. So it might just be an optical thing. Who knows? But be aware of that. All right, let's start us with Instagram. So the Instagram algorithm has now been explained. Now, we've talked about the Instagram algorithm in the past, and what we've had access to is anecdotal data, what people believe is happening. We now actually have data. Facebook's Instagram newsfeed person just went on the record and explained what some of them are at a fairly high level. So here they are. There are four elements. The first is recency. So this means that Instagram prioritizes new posts, newer posts, right? It's not a reverse chronological like it used to be. Still an algorithm in place. But newer posts do indeed get some precedence there. And then there are three things as well. Frequency is how often you actually open the app. So this is not frequency of posting. It's how often you open the app. Now, what we're talking about here, remember, is we're talking about you as the user seeing Instagram photos. So this is not for brand stuff, although we can certainly take advantage of that. And I'll explain more in just a moment. So frequency is how often the user opens the app, because it wants to show you the best post since you last opened. Following is the third one. This means if you follow lots of people, Instagram might show you less from one specific person, so you can see more from all of the people that you follow. And I'll show you some data around what frequency of posting does around that. And the final one is usage, and that is how long you spend on Instagram. So the app determines when to show you the best posts and whether you'll see less important posts. That's as far as they've gone, as far as telling us some things. They did clear up some misconceptions, though. So they are not going back to the reverse chronological thing. There was some news reports saying that they might go back, they might drop the algorithm. I've always said that's not going to happen. Indeed, that is not going to happen. They also don't hide any posts in the feed. So if you keep scrolling, you should see everything posted by everyone you follow eventually. It's not like Facebook's newsfeed, right? Where Facebook will just simply not show you stuff. Instagram will eventually show you everything from the people that you follow, but they do prioritize some stuff. So if you keep scrolling and scrolling strongly, eventually you'll see. They don't actually hide anything algorithmically, although that certainly may change. And they don't downrank for posting too frequently. And they don't downrank for including too many hashtags. So that is what we know so far from Instagram about the Instagram algorithm. Very interesting study from PhotoSlurp came out last week, or maybe early this week. They collected data from 476 fashion and apparel brands on Instagram across a 28-day window. And what they did was they measured the number of likes that they received on all of their own published images. And what it seems to be is that brands don't appear to suffer great engagement rate losses from posting frequently. Now, you do suffer losses for posting frequently. However, let me explain this in two parts. So when you move from half a post per day. So what we're talking about there, of course, is every other day. To 1.5 posts per day, or in other words, 3 posts every 2 days. Does that make sense? So when you move from 1 post every 2 days to 3 posts every 2 days, you do see an engagement drop. You see a drop of 19% in engagement by posting more frequently. Don't freak out. Don't freak out, because remember, there's 2 parts to this. Okay? When we move even further from 1.5 posts per day, so we're really talking there, but well, you know what I'm saying, to 2.5 posts per day, then we get a drop of 9%. And then when you go up to 3.5 posts per day, so that's either 3 or 4 posts a day, you get a further 6% loss in engagement. So the more you post in a day, the more your engagement per post, that's the key here, the more that the engagement per post drops, but the more you post, the less that drop happens. However, this is very important to know, because, you know, this study, people don't read, you know, nobody reads these days. And what they do is they read the headline or they read the first, and everyone freaked out and said, when you post more on Instagram, your engagement drops. Keep reading the article. Keep reading the study. Let the data tell you what's going on here. Because while indeed that is true, engagement per post drops, what happens is you're getting more engagement overall. So what I mean by that is, imagine that you have 1 post a day that you're doing, okay? And you might get 100 likes on it. Now if you move to 2 posts a day, you're gonna drop 20%. So instead of 100 likes on that post each day, you're gonna get 80 likes each post each day. Now that sounds bad, right? But it's not, because remember, you're posting 2 times a day. So now it's 80 plus 80. So now you're getting 160. Does this make sense? I know it's kind of hard to follow without screen stuff. But yes, your engagement per post drops with frequency, but with frequency increases, because you're posting more, you're getting more in the day overall. So in other words, it's okay to post a lot. Some brands are posting 6, 7, 8, 10 times a day. So don't freak out when you see those articles, right? You see those articles saying, don't post frequently on Instagram because if you do, your engagement will drop. Well, sure, your engagement will drop per post, but because you're posting more times in the day, you're getting it more in the day overall. Okay, I don't want to beat that dead horse. But that's basically what's going on here. Oh, also, by the way, before we move on, another interesting part of that study is when they asked people why they unfollow a brand, the response, posting too much, was only 25% of respondents. Only a quarter of people who unfollow you are unfollowing you because you're posting too much. More likely why they're doing it is product relevance and brand interest. So they don't like what the content of it is, or they've lost interest in your brand. That's at 44.5% and 42%. Well above the rates for posting too much. All right. 92% what am I doing here? Sorry, I've got the wrong notes here. So it turns out advertisers are indeed slow to spend money on Instagram stories. So you're not alone there. Some at mention sharing has come out now. So now when someone mentions you in their story, you will be able to share that photo or video into your own story. So when someone mentions you in their story, mentions your brand, you will get a notification in your direct message thread with that person. Now, just for a moment, let me once again bitch about direct messages on Instagram are not yet part of the API. So if you're using a tool like Buffer Reply or Sprout Social or Agora Pulse, or God help you, you're using Hootsuite, they don't have access to DMs at all. And it drives me crazy why Instagram has not built DMs. They've got DMs for Twitter's got DMs in their API. Facebook private messages for brand pages have got it. Instagram DMs, still not available APIs. If you have a Instagram brand page, then you then you have to use it on your mobile app. And if you, like us, use a whole work with a whole bunch of different brands, you are logging in and out of it every time to respond. It is a real pain. I really hope they fix that. Hi, Daryl. Welcome. Thanks. I'm glad you find these informative. So here's what happens. When someone mentions your brand in their story, you will get a notification in your direct message thread with that person. So you'll see an option to add that content to your own story. And then you can tap it. You can see that story as a sticker, right? So it comes in like a sticker, essentially, which you can do whatever you want to. You can scale it, rotate it, position it. You can add creative tools like text on top of it. When followers see your story, the original poster's username will show up and will be tappable, so they can flip over to that person as well. Just a note we're talking about here, only public accounts can have their story shared. The new option... this new option here, you can share Instagram posts to your Facebook brand page now. I know, Brianna, don't even get me started on Hootsuite. I love them personally. I have friends who work there. But their app. So this new option will highlight your Instagram posts within Facebook. So these are your brand's Instagram posts. They'll highlight them on Facebook. It's not clear to me whether this, by the way, translates to brand pages. So I keep saying brand, but this could just be personal profiles. I have not seen this in the wild yet. And then what it'll do is it'll give you a chance to share your Instagram photos that you've posted to your Facebook profile without ever leaving the app or the story. You know, these apps have remained separate. Facebook's been trying more cross-promoting, cross-integration things lately. All right, so that is Instagram. Oh my God, Brianna, it is absolutely working molasses. Honestly, if you want to see my rant about Hootsuite, go to toddmaffin.com/Hootsuite. Interesting story. Received a letter from their legal team last week, not a letter, an email, telling me I had to remove their logo and references to us being a Hootsuite marketing partner. Their logo doesn't appear on our site. We are not a Hootsuite marketing partner. It may have been a generic letter. Maybe the intention was they wanted me to take the blog post down. I don't know. It's an opinion piece. It's fair comment. And I've asked them like two or three times if they wanted to correct the record, if I had anything inaccurate on that, and they had never responded to it. Anyway, toddmaffin.com/Hootsuite if you're looking for some shits and giggles there. Over to Facebook. Very interesting study coming out from Parsley. No big surprise here, right? The top referrers. Now, what a referrer is, are the websites that are sending your company's website traffic. It used to be, when we look back at March of last year, Facebook was on top, and what we're really seeing here is a bit of the algorithm change, right? So less and less and less and less and less, and Google climbing back to its position, to its original position. Interestingly, around about a month ago or 3 weeks ago, kind of mid-May, there was a jump. It did go up a little bit. So, is this an algorithm change on Facebook's end? Marketers learning how to exploit the new algorithm? We don't know. So a little bit of a jump, but as you can see, it's not a huge jump. It's not a huge jump. Facebook TV. So Facebook is now partnering with some big brands like Anderson Cooper, the Fox guy, Shepard Smith, with actual shows. So Anderson Cooper's Facebook show is called The 180, because, we're hip and cool. That's what the young kids want. But it has a time slot. You know, 6:25 Eastern time every day. I don't think it's launched yet, but this is Facebook's way of getting into becoming appointment-based TV. When I was in radio, we called it appointment-based listening, which means you set a time to watch it, right? Trying to get away from on-demand stuff. It's a specific time. Facebook is paying these people to do this, by the way, and they can run ads in it. There's Vox has one. I think there were about six or seven brands, so that'll be interesting to see. Facebook is now giving people the option to boost marketplace posts. Now, this is for people, not for brands. Users will set up their ad budget, how long they want to run the ad for. So this is if you're selling a rug. I'm looking for a rug right now on Facebook Marketplace. This is the Craigslist killer. Because as you may be able to hear, this room is very echoey here in my new office. So I want a rug to hang on the wall. That'll help with acoustics. So I've been looking for like a cheap $10 shag rug. And it's really good. You can say in my neighborhood, within 2 kilometers, anytime a rug is posted, light up a little red dot beside Marketplace. So now people will be able to boost, those things for, you know, those marketplaces. Why would you want to boost a post that you're of something you're selling? Maybe you're moving and you have to get rid of it really quickly. Who knows why? Maybe it's a business, you know, that's actually doing that stuff. Facebook experimented with this about 2 or 3 years ago, where people were able to boost their personal posts on your personal profile, nothing to do with brands, to get it out to more of your friends. I tried it. It was only up for a couple of weeks, and then they took it down. And I think the reason they took it down was because it was letting companies, you know, there's still a lot of companies out there who have brand pages that are actually people profiles, right? They're actually profile pages. So to add fans, you have to add them as a friend. And then there's a limit of 5,000 friends on Facebook, and there's no advertising. And I think what they were doing was they took it down because they didn't want to encourage people to sort of sneak around the brand page way. So that doesn't exist anymore. But now on Marketplace, it kind of does again. It's kind of come back, which is sort of interesting to see. But the targeting options are really weak. All you'll be able to target is are zip codes. Those are American postal codes. So the Marketplace ads will show up between regular listings. So these are very similar to newsfeed ads. And now for brand people, for marketers like you and me, Marketplace shows up now in automatic placements. So let's talk briefly about automatic placements. Never use automatic placements. So this is when you go to create an ad or a campaign, to be more accurate. Remember, there's 3 levels in it, right? There's a campaign. That's your goal. There's the ad set, that's the budget and audience and placement. And then there's the ad, that's all the creative and tracking and stuff like that. So the ad set level is placements, right? So, and budget and audience. But placements is where do you want this ad to appear? And so there's news feed, there's right-hand column, which is actually still really good for brand recognition. Terrible for conversions. Messenger got added there, now there's Marketplace. Why never use automatic? Because what Facebook will do, if instead of automatic, go and choose individually. It takes 5 more seconds, but choose where you want them to go. Because with automatic, Facebook decides where it's going to go. And even though Facebook says, we're going to place this where it's most effective for you, they, my friends, are lying to you. What they're actually doing is putting it where they have the most inventory. So if you are posting something with automatic placements, which includes a ton of stuff, right? If newsfeed, right-hand column, Instagram, Messenger, Marketplace, instant articles, audience network, it goes everywhere. They're going to put it where they have the most inventory. And that's probably going to be instant articles. And Instagram Stories has quite a bit of inventory these days. And they're not great for conversion. Especially instant art, or especially, excuse me, not instant articles, especially audience network, which are like banner ads on mobile apps and things like that. So never use automatic placements. But if you do, just beware that they are there now. Marketplace are there. All right. So this is interesting. Remember how Facebook tried to buy Snapchat? They told them to stick it. So they went and made a Snapchat killer in Instagram Stories. Meet Facebook's next copy and kill target, Musical.ly. And we talked about Musical.ly about 2 months ago when they launched. I gave you a heads up on them. This was acquired by a Chinese company for a little under $1 billion last fall. Basically, it's kind of Snapchatty, but it's kids, mostly kids, lip syncing. And that's the app, essentially. Side note, I can lip sync all of the words to Bring the Noise by Public Enemy. Word for word. I don't know why a 48-year-old guy should have that skill, but I do. So Musical.ly was acquired somewhere between $800 million and $1 billion last fall by a Chinese company. Used to be considered kind of this big, huge, up-and-coming marketing platform. It had a lot of hype around it, especially younger consumers and lip-syncing the popularity around there. But it really struggled to find advertisers, mostly because it had still kind of limited reach and really high ad rates. And so Mark Zuckerberg took a look at it and said, hey, let's copy and kill them. Meet Lip Sync. which is going to be a new option now. This is really bad. I'm sorry about the quality here. Does my mouse... Can you see my mouse? I don't know if you can see my mouse. Yeah, you can. So, yeah, no, you can't. Never mind. So in that middle photo there, and again, if you're on a podcast, listening as a podcast, my apologies, you can't see this, but please do go to thisweek.news so you can watch it and watch us live. So that middle photo there, the red box on the bottom is how you turn on Lip Sync Live. Still testing. Plans to make it available globally. Look out musically. According to Facebook, people will read 20% more of an instant article post. They look like regular links to websites, but instead of seeing the content on a website, you see it within Facebook, so it loads 10 times faster than a regular web link. Facebook also says that readers are about 70% less likely to abandon an instant article post, by the way. Here's the other thing about instant articles. I don't have any data to validate this. But I believe it to be true. I switched over to instant articles on my own website, and I think we did for EngageQ as well. It required a bit of technical know-how. You've got to install a plugin to WordPress if you run WordPress and tweak a bunch of stuff and upload a CSS or upload an RSS feed, and Facebook denies your first attempt. I mean, it's a little more complicated. But I do believe that instant articles get a stronger push in the algorithm because Facebook wants to see people stay on their platform, and you do stay on their platform when you're reading an instant article. So I do believe, and I some of the data I've seen just from our own sites backs that out. I haven't seen any sort of proper data, but interesting to know. So now they have this new application. So this is a program that you download. It doesn't run in the browser. There's a Mac application, and there's a Windows application, and it is an instant articles builder. I have not played with this. I've downloaded it this morning. If it's of interest, I will bring it back next week, and we can talk about it. But worth downloading if you run instant articles. Excuse me. Yes, Facebook wants you to upload your nude photos to them. This is not a joke. Here's why they want you to do it. All right. So they want you to upload all your nudes to them. And then what they're going to do is they're going to create a fingerprint, a digital fingerprint, just very similar to the way that music companies do this on YouTube and Facebook, right? If you've ever uploaded a video on YouTube that's had some copyrighted, you know, rights protected music in it, it gets taken down immediately. And it's not like people are listening and going, oh, hey, that's Michael Jackson, let's delete it. It's an algorithm that has a fingerprint of all of the major labels' songs. And so if it matches the fingerprint, it knows, okay, that's a commercial song. It's not allowed. So that's what they're going to do is you're going to upload your nudes to Facebook. And they will create a fingerprint of it and then delete your nudes but maintain the fingerprint data. So that, here's the reason why, if anyone else, like a jilted ex-lover of yours, uploads your nude photos, they'll match it and they will not let them go up online. If you want to trust Facebook with this, go right ahead. I'm not, I mean, I don't have any nudes, but there you go. There is a pivoting to traditional ads here. Facebook changed its news feed to prioritize user content over branded or publisher content, as you probably know. CPM prices, that's cost per thousand views, have increased dramatically. And of course, with less ads, right? With fewer ads out there, impressions have sunk and so on. After the big algorithm change in January, CPMs shot up more than double, up to 122% year over year as that impression rate dropped, according to ad stage data. So this Digiday study spoke with 10, so small number, but 10 direct-to-consumer companies. All of them report that they have de-emphasized Facebook in their marketing mix, moving to other digital alternatives. So this headline's a little bit wrong, notably Instagram. And the reason is the prices are getting too high, and they think the feed has become pretty cluttered. Part of the spend is going to Instagram stories, by the way, because there's more inventory there. A couple of things I noticed just out there in the wild. Again, Facebook doesn't have like an updates folder or something. You just have to kind of see it when it shows up. They are removing the ability to boost shared posts. Okay, not a big deal. But that's coming out in 10 days. And I saw this. This is kind of nice. When you remove someone from a Facebook group, they've added this. They give you the ability to – this is my wife. they give you the ability to delete that person's posts from the last 7 days, delete their comments, block them. And you can apply those changes to other groups. So in case that person shows up in other groups as well. Yeah, kind of interesting. And finally, on Pinterest, Pinterest is introducing these, our new full screen video ads. So they basically show up on mobile as you're scrolling down and those sorts of things. We are at exactly 30 minutes to the second. But before we go to questions and we say goodbye to the podcast people, as you know, I don't make any money off this. We don't charge for these weekly shows. I rarely put affiliate links in it. I rarely ask you for anything. However, this week is different. And the reason for that is that I'm raising money for something very personal to me. And I'm hoping that you can help if you found your time here valuable, if you've shown up on a regular basis and you have made money or saved money or something like that from some of this stuff. About 10 years ago, I was suffering from a pretty significant addiction. I went to this treatment center here on Vancouver Island called Edgewood, and it literally saved my life. Addictions treatment is awfully expensive. There are free options. They have varying success rates. There are a lot of people in need that do not have access to treatment, and it can save their life. And I am raising money for them. And in addition to just sort of regular stuff, I have kind of a series of perks available. My favorite is the $25 level. This is the magician. I will send you a YouTube video showing you my favorite magic trick. You can do it with your smartphone. It will blow people's mind. I promise you, when you get this video and you show it to people, it will blow their minds. The one that I think most of you may find value is the benefactor level at $100. I'm going to be doing an exclusive, in-depth, hour-and-a-half digital marketing training session, exclusive just to people at the benefactor level. There are higher levels, of course. At Superhero, I will come to your office and do a 2.5-hour training session for your team. The last time I did this, my goal for this fundraising is $5,000. As of this morning, I've raised $2,350. The last time I did this, I raised $4,500 and change, and I was their top fundraiser. And I'm kind of competitive, so I really want to get there again. But if you feel like you've benefited from your time here or something like that, or feel have a personal connection to someone with addiction, please help me get others into treatment as well. It literally saved my life. And so the website address is toddmaffin.com/treatment. So we're going to leave it there. Don't forget, you can visit the website thisweek.news. That's where you can watch this as a video replay. You can also check out the past episodes. But most importantly, you can sign up to get a weekly sneak peek at the agenda and a reminder to tune in. And if you are watching this on video, there's also a link there to get this as an audio podcast. So that's it. We're going to say goodbye to you beautiful podcast people. Thank you so much for being with us. And I'll see you again 1 week from today from Vancouver Island on This Week in Digital Marketing. And as for the rest of you, I will come back here and check my comments and see Copacabana, Allison. Yeah, that's a good one. Honestly, Bring the Noise is fun to learn. Daryl says, posting blog content. Let me move this here. Daryl says, posting blog content right in the post works too. People don't like leaving Facebook once they're in it. Yeah, it's true. Doesn't Facebook own the images then legally? No, they don't. This is a very common misconception with terms and conditions. You know, it's in Instagram, and everyone freaks out when a new platform comes on. God, my hair is atrocious this morning, isn't it? Jeez. There is a clause in all of these terms and conditions that say that you give us the non-exclusive worldwide right to show these images. You have to give them that right to show their images. Otherwise, they don't have permission to use them on the platform. When you if you don't agree to that, when you upload a photo to Instagram, they can't do anything with it because you haven't given them permission. So they don't own your photos. No, it doesn't happen. You still own your copyright. Jonathan, thank you so much. I'm really glad. Angela, right on. And Sean and Albert and Jen. Everyone else, thanks. So any questions about what we covered here this morning? Otherwise, I am going to leave for the day because Jocelyn on our team is monitoring our engagement and moderation now. McKenna is leaving shift in about half an hour, and I got a new Oculus Rift this morning from Amazon, and I'm going to play with it because I take Friday afternoons off after this. Jonathan asks, are hashtags seriously important, or is relevant posting? Hashtags are kind of important, you know. Hashtags are important for two reasons. One is for branding. So if you have a campaign and you want some consistency, if you've got a campaign with a branding message, you know, like, I don't know, dollars for dogs. It's a terrible one. But if, you know, that's something you use in your marketing collateral and you kind of build a campaign around that messaging, then sure, that's important to use. Hashtags are also important to use for discovering things. But, you know, I mean, if you're not a fashion brand, if you're not, there's not a ton of value for it. You know, there's no harm in doing it. I think we post, you know, hashtag digital marketing, hashtag social media on ours, which technically gets us into the discover section if we get a lot of engagement, but those are so overloaded, right? I mean, outfit of the day, OOTD, overloaded, cute, dogs of Instagram, cats of Instagram, you know, people use them hoping that they'll get up into the discover page in the algorithm, and they will, but because they're so overloaded, with other people using that hashtag, that you have to have a ton of engagement to get there. So it doesn't hurt you. It might help you. It's not critical. Anything else before I leave for the week and play with my Oculus Rift? All right. I don't see anything. Once again, for those of you, do you white label social media monitoring? Do we white label it? Not 100% sure what you mean. We provide social media monitoring for all of our clients. We do white label to agencies for large clients of theirs. We do engagement and moderation, so we're on their channels answering on behalf of the brand as if we are, you know, answering as the brand. We have coverage from 7 in the morning until 9 at night. Pacific time. We have people across the country, literally in almost every time zone. And we don't outsource to like the Philippines or India or anything like that. They all work for EngageQ. They're all Canadian English language speakers, first language, all that kind of stuff. So we do white label for agencies. Okay, gotcha, Daryl. Yeah, but social media monitoring just comes with our service, you know. So we have spike alerts. We do monitoring for brand names, for hashtags. We monitor for locations around Instagram, you know. So, for example, the Sheraton Wall Center is a client of ours. It's the biggest hotel west of Toronto, 700-plus rooms. We monitor everything. Their brand name, we monitor, obviously, mentions and DMs and tweets and things like that. We monitor Instagram geo location. So if someone takes a photo and it's on their property and they geotag it, or it's in the area, we monitor for that as well. Every agency that's doing that should be doing that. So we certainly do as well. So once again, thank you, everyone. If you have someone in your family or a friend who's been affected by addiction, or if you found value in these sessions, I would really appreciate it if you pay it back just a little. Again, that website address is toddmaffin.com/treatment. This all goes to a walk, basically, that happens on the 22nd, I think, here in Nanaimo. It's actually kind of a nice little coincidence that Edgewood, which is the treatment center that I went to that saved my life, is actually based here in Nanaimo. So I'm kind of returning to that area, which is sort of nice. But I would really appreciate it. toddmaffin.com/treatment. And that is it. Thank you, folks, so much. I will see you again 1 week from today. Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.